The word hemostasis can be broken down into hemo, referring to blood or bleeding, and stasis, meaning to stop. So together it means stopping bleeding. Hemostasis has two phases, primary and secondary hemostasis. In primary hemostasis, platelets aggregate to form a plug at the site of an injured blood vessel. While these platelets are aggregating, coagulation, or secondary hemostasis, begins. This is where numerous enzymes that are always floating around in the blood, called clotting factors, get proteolytically activated, meaning that activation happens when a small piece is chopped off, a bit like pulling the pin out of a grenade. These factors activate one another, eventually leading to the activation of fibrin, or factor 1A. That results in a fibrin mesh which forms around the platelet plug to reinforce it and hold it together. Without primary and secondary hemostasis, our body would suffer massive blood loss from even the most minor injuries. Imagine losing all of your blood volume from something as simple as a pinprick. Now, let's get down into the nitty-gritty of secondary hemostasis. The process of forming the fibrin mesh begins via two pathways, the extrinsic and intrinsic pathways. The intrinsic pathway is called intrinsic because all of the factors required to activate it are intrinsic, or found within the blood. Conversely, the extrinsic pathway is called extrinsic because it's activated by tissue factor found extrinsically, or outside of the blood. Both pathways can become activated independently and ultimately culminate in the activation of factor 10, which then proceeds to activate the rest of the coagulation cascade via the common pathway. So let's start with the extrinsic pathway. It starts when trauma damages the blood vessel and exposes the cells under the endothelial layer, something like smooth muscle cells, which have tissue factor or factor 3 in their membrane. Now, it turns out that there's an enzyme called factor 7 floating around in the blood, and some of it is active, meaning that it's already set to proteolytically cleave other proteins. When it's in that state, it's called active factor 7, or 7A, A meaning active. Factor 7A binds to a tissue factor and a calcium ion, which get released by nearby activated platelets, and it forms a 7A TF complex on the surface of the smooth muscle cell. Both the calcium ions and tissue factors are cofactors, meaning that they need to bind to the enzyme factor 7A to allow it to really get going. This complex then cleaves clotting factor 10, yielding the active form, called factor 10A. Once factor 10A is generated via the extrinsic pathway, it cleaves factor 5 into 5A, and then it uses factor 5A and a calcium ion as the cofactors to form the prothrombinase complex, which activates prothrombin, or factor 2, into just plain old thrombin, or factor 2A. In fact, each prothrombinase complex can activate thousands of thrombin, so there's an enormous amplification that occurs at this step. Thrombin uses calcium ions as a cofactor, and it has a number of procoagulative effects. First, thrombin binds to receptors on platelets, causing them to activate. Activated platelets change their shape to form tentacle-like arms that allow them to stick to other platelets. Second, thrombin activates three cofactors: factor 5, which is used in the common pathway, factor 8, and fabin, which proteolytically cleaves fibrinogen, or factor 1, into factor 1A, also known as fibrin. Third, the effect of thrombin on fibrinogen plays a big role. See, fibrinogen is soluble in blood, but fibrin isn't, so fibrin precipitates out of the plasma and forms long protein chains that are like ropes. The fibrin tethers platelets to one another, holding the platelet plug together. And fourth, thrombin proteolytically cleaves stabilizing factor, or factor 13, into factor 13A. Factor 13A combines with a calcium ion cofactor to form crosslinks between the fibrin chains, further reinforcing the fibrin mesh. This is where the intrinsic pathway comes into play. The intrinsic pathway starts when a circulating factor 12 comes into contact with negatively charged phosphates on the membrane of activated platelets or subendothelial collagen exposed by trauma. Then it undergoes conformational change to get activated into factor 12A. Factor 12A proteolytically cleaves factor 11 into factor 11A, which combines with a calcium ion to proteolytically cleave factor 9 into 9A. Recall that thrombin also works at this step to activate factor 9 into 9A. Finally, 9A forms a complex with a calcium ion and factor 8A, and this complex proteolytically cleaves factor 10 into 10A. It's important to note that factor VIII degrades rapidly in the blood if it's not bound to a protein called von Willebrand's factor, which is released by activated platelets in endothelial cells during primary hemostasis. Now, there are two blood tests used to test coagulation. The prothrombin time, or PT, tests whether the extrinsic pathway is working. You can think playing tennis, which is done outdoors. Also, there's the activated partial thromboplastin time, or APTT, or just PTT, which tests whether the intrinsic pathway is working. You can think playing table tennis, which is done indoors. Now, to remember the various factors in both pathways, let's use a mnemonic. Let's start with agent 007, representing factor 7, who's sneezing into a tissue for tissue factor because he's been playing tennis for PT outside for extrinsic pathway. Agent 007 then simply hops on the common train for common pathway. Meanwhile, we have a farmer carrying 12 eggs for factor 12 on his way back from playing table tennis for PTT indoors for intrinsic pathway. He clumsily drops an egg, so now there's only 11 for factor 11. Suddenly, a mean alley cat with 9 lives for factor 9 jumps in his way. The farmer kicks his boot off at the cat, which hits it, and for the purpose of the mnemonic, the cat dies, so now that it only has 8 lives for factor 8. The farmer then also hops on the common train. The train carriage has 10 seats available for factor 10, but 5 of them are occupied for factor 5. Some more people sit down, and soon there are only 2 seats left for factor 2, and then just 1 for factor 1. Agent 007 and the farmer look at each other, and then scramble over to grab it. Who do you think got the seat? Alright, as a quick recap. Secondary hemostasis involves the formation of a fibrin mesh via the coagulation cascade. Coagulation starts when collagen and activated platelets activate the intrinsic pathway by activating factor 12, which activates factor 11, which activates factor 9, which activates factor 10. Factor 10 starts the common pathway where it activates factor 2, which activates factor 1 that builds the fibrin mesh. When factor 2 gets activated, it also activates 4 other factors, 5, 8, 9, and 13. Factor 5 gets activated and acts as a cofactor for 10. Factor 8 acts as a cofactor for factor 9, and factor 13 helps factor 1, or fibrin, form crosslinks. In the extrinsic pathway, exposed tissue factor activates factor 7, which activates factor 10, and starts the common pathway. Factors 2, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 13 need calcium as a cofactor in order to function.